My name is David Garner. I am an associate professor of systematic theology at Westminster Theological Seminary. I've been in the PCA for many years, have served as a pastor, as well as a missionary with Mission to the World in Eastern Europe, and now this last 10 years have been serving at Westminster. It is the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, and this year is a big deal around the world as we celebrate that. I'm reminded of what Roland Bainton stated in the introduction to his book on the Reformation of the 16th century. He argues that one of the primary causes of the Reformation was actually a longing by the Protestants to extricate themselves from the complexities of Roman Catholic Church tradition and practice and the complexities of the political and churchly interface and the corruption associated with that. And there was a longing, as Bainton puts it, to return to the simplicity of years prior, to go back to the simplicity of the gospel as preached by the apostles. As we today discuss what's on my mind concerning the life of the church in the 21st century and the PCA, I think like every generation, we need to return to the question, are we abiding in, delighting in the simplicity, the sweet and sacred simplicity of the gospel? There's so many voices in our ears in the 21st century with modern technology and all of its noise, the din of all of these cultural pressures and all sorts of things that come at us that can actually put us in a place in which we feel wholly threatened and even very insecure about our position as ministers of the gospel, as teaching and ruling elders in the PCA. And I just think one of the sweet things of the gospel is the simplicity of a trust and faith in God's word. So I want to just talk about that briefly now as I think about the PCA in the 21st century. Paul, in his letter to Timothy, 1 Timothy, closes chapter 4 with these words, "Keep a close watch on yourself, Timothy, and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing you will save both yourself and your hearers." Paul gives Timothy this exhortation to keep watch on his teaching and on himself. I want to talk about the simplicity of the gospel for the man, the simplicity of the message, the simplicity of the method, and the simplicity of the mission. Just in a few comments here. First, the simplicity of the gospel for the man. Paul reminds Timothy that he is a steward of the mysteries of God, but he's also a recipient of the blessed gospel. And Paul urges Timothy earlier in this text to be mindful of his speech, his conduct, his love, his faith, and his purity. And a calling back just the simple trust as a man of God in the things of God, to rest there and to not allow the din of everything around Timothy to drown out that sweet calling as a man of ministry. You know, I think about so many ways, so many temptations for us in ministry today about whether it's personality cult, whether it's temptations to impurity through the internet and pornography and all sorts of things that can tempt us. But there are also other temptations. I think one of my professors many years ago describes the handshaking at the end of the service as a pastor stands at the back door as the glorification of the worm ceremony. And I think there's a longing in our hearts often for affirmation, for kudos, to have people say, "Wow, Pastor, that was a fabulous sermon." And very subtly and yet no less dangerously, we can slip in to believing that ministry success is actually about me and my name. I would suggest that the simplicity of the gospel calls us to not think about ourselves as a magnet, but more as a mirror. That is our calling actually to draw people to us or to reflect Christ to them? I think Paul says, Timothy, let me remind you to be an example in conduct, in speech, in love, in faith, and in purity. A man who had been in ministry for over 50 years was telling a little bit about his ministry experience. And I remember him telling the story that after a particular Sunday sermon, he was driving home with his wife. And he was awaiting her commendations for his sermon. And it was just dead silence in the car. And finally, he couldn't stand it anymore. And he said to her, "Well, what did you think of the sermon?" And she responded, "You thought it was pretty good, didn't you?" And it struck him at that moment that his ministry was all wrapped up in his sense of worth and value as a minister. And she hit the nail on the head when she said, "You know, this is not about you." And he describes that event as actually instrumental in the early years of his ministry, where he sought, instead of being a magnet, to actually be a mirror. So the simplicity of the gospel for the man. Secondly, the simplicity of the gospel concerning our message. As a professor, I'm very mindful that theology is not a creative enterprise, but it's actually a receptive one. That we, as the stewards of the mysteries of God, receive God's word. We receive his revelation, and our responsibility is to speak back God's thoughts to him. That as we preach, as we teach, Paul reminds Timothy to be very diligent, to be a good steward of the mysteries of God, to guard the deposit. We, in our ministry, must not allow all of the pressures of cultural relevance and allow the new techniques in ministry to lead us to think that our success is going to be found in somehow our own ideas or our own strengths or our own abilities, but instead to actually deliver faithfully in our message, the simple, sweet, glorious message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we are to receive that message and then to deliver that message. That's actually exactly what the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15. "That which I received is what I delivered unto you." It's a sweet simplicity. We are not creators, we are receivers, and we are to deliver only that which we have received. So there's a simplicity of the gospel for us as ministers, as men. There is a simplicity of the gospel concerning the message. I would suggest that Clowney's comments are worth restating here. He says, let others develop pulpit fads of the pressing age, but let us specialize in preaching Christ. I think that simple call to preach Christ is as relevant today as it was 500 years ago at the start of the Reformation. Thirdly, not only the simplicity, the sweet and sacred simplicity of the gospel for the man, for the message, but also for the method. I am one who came later into the Reformed faith. I went to a seminary that was not Reformed, and it was actually there that I met the Reformed faith. But I remember one particular course that I took, in which at the time was when all of the new publications on church growth dynamics, and these different models of ministry were just flowing out the presses. And so we were asked to read a number of these books on church growth methods. And I remember reading them and wondering, as a student, how is it that I will ever be discerning enough to know which method to choose when I go to my place of calling. When I become a pastor, I don't think I'm smart enough to figure out which of these techniques is going to work best where I am serving. And I think it was as I came to understand the Reformed faith that God has not only given us the message, but also the method, there was a life-giving freedom in relying upon and delighting in the sweet simplicity of the ordinary means of grace for ministry that was not only freeing in the sense of I don't have to figure this out, but it also then has enabled me through the years as a pastor as well as a missionary to be appropriately adaptive in my context, to contextualize, but to do so on the authority of God's word and the sweet simplicity of the ordinary means of grace, of the preaching of God's word, the teaching of God's word, and of prayer, and relying upon God's methods rather than my own for success in ministry. Paul, in the same text, in verse 13 of 1 Timothy 4 says this, "Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, and to teaching." Wow, how delightfully simple is that? Paul says, Timothy, this is the method that is relevant to every age. Trust in the God-given method. Finally, not only the simplicity, the sacred simplicity for the man, for the message, and for the method, but I would say also for the mission of the church. There are so many important and pressing issues upon the church worldwide today. Just think about the challenges politically, in terms of issues of financial concern, of moral concern, of social justice concerns, all of which the gospel speaks to. There's no question about that. But I would suggest that we risk, as the church seek to engage those things, sometimes we can engage them in ways that really isn't what is primary for us. So I would just simply say this, as we consider our calling as the church, let us never forget the sweet simplicity of the call to go and make disciples. No one else can do that. Only the Church of Jesus Christ can do that. B.B. Warfield, in a lecture that he gave to prospective missionaries back in the late 19th century, made the following assessment of missionaries with whom he had spoken. He says that the greatest risk to the missionary on the field as he goes out to convert the heathen is that he instead will actually be converted by the heathen. What I think Warfield was getting at is, as we in our human compassion want to situate our message and deliver our message in a way that will be compelling and that people will want to hear, sometimes we end up actually so changing our method and our message that we no longer remain distinctly faithful to the sweet simplicity of the gospel. And Warfield was mindful that missionaries risk actually becoming like those to whom they've gone to preach rather than calling them to be like the Christ whom they ought to preach. Simply put then, I would want to suggest, as we think about life and ministry in the PCA in the 21st century, that we need to be mindful of the propensity of our hearts to drift away from that which is core, that which is central, and that which is gloriously simple. And that is a reliance upon the Word of God, even as the Reformers called us back to. Sola Scriptura leads us to solus Christus, to Christ alone. Robert Dick Wilson, who was one of the first professors at Westminster back in 1929 when Westminster started, he was a professor of Old Testament, is known to have said the following about students that he had taught either at Princeton or at Westminster. And that is, "I only need to hear one sermon of my students to know how they're going to do in ministry. I only need to hear one." And this is what I'm looking for. As I listen to that sermon, does that student have a big God or a small God? Or as he was apt to put it, is this student a big Godder or is he a small Godder? I would suggest that the sweet simplicity of the gospel calls us to proclaim a really, really big God whose message is about Christ and Christ alone, that we are to preach faithfully and to rely upon the sweet simplicity of the gospel for us as ministers, to rely upon the sweet simplicity of the gospel message, of the gospel method, and the mission of the church to proclaim Christ to the four corners of the earth.